Boldwood presents The Beach House, written by Nina Manning and read by Lucy Scott. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Boldwood. For Sarah, Geraldine and Sue, the best bookie gals. I love ya. X. Prologue. The beach house sits on a cliff overlooking the sea. A sanctuary. A retreat. Somewhere to come to escape the endless madness and feel secure. You can walk around the house, feel the space that surrounds you, yet also feel safe within its walls. The beach house is a holiday home, but a home nonetheless. But under the floorboards and between each brick, secrets linger. They cling to the curtains and are soaked deep within the fabric of every sofa and mattress. They echo in the hallway and corridors. People come and go, visitors, family, unaware of what went on, of the secrets that are tightly contained between the walls. The beach house has seen so much already, and just when it thinks it can't take any more, four women arrive. Each one of them harbouring secrets that could harm the other ones. But the old house can do nothing, except sit back and watch, as it always does. Chapter 1. Nicole. She had used the word slut. Who said slut these days? Not anyone Nicole knew, and certainly not a woman on their own podcast, for goodness sake. She didn't feel like herself recently. In fact, she would say she had been out of sorts for a while now. She couldn't put a date on it, but if she had to, and if she was going to be really honest, it all began when she had been about 8. This feeling of uncertainty. A notion that she had forgotten to do something. That feeling you get as an adult when you leave the house in a rush and you aren't sure if you have your phone or if you turned off the iron. She had tried to suffocate it, to pretend it wasn't there, or that maybe it was part of her personality, who she was. She knew she shouldn't have said it. Slut. The word hurt her heart. It was harsh, brutal, but it had just slipped out. Audrey had been sitting opposite her, looking as pristine and glorious as the beginning of a spring day, as they recorded another episode of their hit podcast show, Laying It Bare. What had been a typical Instagram live for them quickly dissolved into a disaster. And because the podcast was being recorded live, whose idea that had been, she had no clue, it had seemed like an absolute perfect opportunity to really lay it bare, they couldn't edit it out. Well, Nicole had insisted, and it was her studio, her podcast, her money. To remove it now would cause a stir. It would look like they had made a mistake, and Nicole didn't want anyone to see that she had made a mistake. That was unthinkable. Better to keep it in and forget the whole thing. People would move past it soon enough, and then the next episode would be out. Nicole had already got great ideas for that one, which would make everyone roar with laughter. The nasty little word would be long forgotten. She hadn't meant it, not in the way it came out anyway. But how could she explain that to the listeners? She couldn't, because she could barely even explain it to herself. Just look at the comments, Graham, her boyfriend, had said to her over dinner the night the podcast went live. You need to accept that what you've done could have catastrophic consequences for the business. The weeks had passed, and the figures were in. Followers lost on socials and the podcast ratings were down on the months even prior to the slut comment. What was happening? Matt, the sound engineer, had tried to explain it to her, but she couldn't concentrate. She was always half somewhere else, in that place where she went to shake off the feeling that she had left something behind. She had launched into the Laying It Bare podcast without any thought, planning or preparation. She and her co-host, Audrey, had met a few years ago, when Nicole had leased the building and installed the pods to let out for recordings. Audrey was her secret weapon. Ex-supermodel and all-round bloody superwoman. But now everything was in ruins. By using that word, she had undone everything that the podcast represented. She had taken it too far, crossed the invisible moral line. As well as Audrey, there were two others on Nicole's small team, Margo and Paisley. And they were all different in many ways. There was surely not one thing that bound the four of them, except the studio, which Nicole knew they all loved, and it had quickly become an important part of each of their lives. None more so than Nicole's. She needed it in a way that was purely personal to her. She was sure the same was for Paisley, the studio receptionist, who dealt with the everyday admin, checking in the pod users and anything else in between. Paisley had a quiet dedication to her job that was unlike anything Nicole had witnessed in the 20 years she had been working. Nicole knew that Paisley would be looking for a pay rise soon, a promotion of sorts. But behind that pretty little demeanor, Nicole knew there was a woman who would stop at nothing to get where she wanted to be. She was the type of person who was ready to step in someone else's shoes without hesitation. Margot, introverted yet able to turn her hand to any task, was Nicole's personal assistant. Then there was Audrey, a star in her own right. Nicole couldn't deny Audrey was the only thing holding the podcast together. Audrey had a huge following on social media, and the show's fans came to listen to her. Nicole was a mere nobody in comparison. And now things were starting to go wrong. Nicole felt she had done the right thing by taking on premises just outside of central London, and she figured people would travel for great quality audio studios where they could record adverts, podcasts, or audiobooks. Perhaps she should have thought that part through more. They did come, but not in the masses that Nicole had expected them to. And as she started to think about it, which she had been a lot recently, she realised that Laying It Bare was not an original name for a podcast, and what they were talking about was not very original. They weren't covering any subjects that hadn't been talked about 1,000 times already. Nicole adjusted her headphones, the thoughts of what was to come, where she was headed with her colleagues creeping into her consciousness. She knew they would be wrapping up soon, and Audrey would open her phone and begin her usual post-show tweets and other social stuff. Things that made no sense to Nicole. She could manage the odd tweet at an absolute push if she really had to, but Instagram, TikTok, she kept well away from it. She knew she needed to be seen making this thing work, but Nicole had tried to remain as anonymous as possible for a long time. She didn't like to flaunt herself around on the social channels. She knew she could be found if someone really wanted to find her. Nicole often thought back to this time last year, when her life was up in the air, and she had no idea what was going to fall next and cause more damage. Luckily, nothing did. And instead, out of the blue, she was invited onto a local news channel to speak on a feature about mental decluttering. During the interview, she happened to mention her Instagram handle, and the next thing she knew, Audrey Westwood had got in touch and asked if she wanted to collaborate. 12 months later, here they were. No conversation was off the table. Menopause, mental health, sex, drugs. Honesty was what drew the listeners in. But it still wasn't enough. Audrey was chatting away opposite her, some anecdote about a modelling contract that had taken a sour turn. I was the only woman in the room. I would say there were about 20 men. Nicole was sure she had heard this story before, but she nodded along, played her part, began to think of the right question to ask next. Audrey was lining her up with some good fodder here. This next episode could be a hit if she got it just right. She needed to try to steer this conversation towards something that would grasp the attention of the listeners enough that they wanted to share it and talk about it with others. At what point did you begin to feel uncomfortable? Nervous? Nicole leant forwards, hoping that the sudden drop in the tone of her voice would make her sound intrigued, add some depth and drama to the content. She already knew what Audrey's response would be. I wasn't nervous or scared, not once. This is my job, this is what I do. I parade around in front of lots of people. I don't feel intimidated by men. I felt more intimidated being in a room alone with Naomi Campbell than I have in a room with multiple males. Audrey flapped her hand around as she spoke. I knew what I looked like that day, Audrey continued. I was a sex object. That was the whole purpose of the photo shoot. I was selling underwear that would turn men on and then they would buy it for their wives or partners. Audrey was settled into the expensive chair that Nicole had sourced for the podcast. Non-squeak, yet you could sink down into them. Nicole had a well-earned nap in one once. If the whole business failed, those chairs were coming with her. Audrey carried on, setting the scene, labelling each of the male journalists in that room with a characteristic, a tick or something they were wearing. By the end of that session, I was giving them tips on how to woo the significant other in their life. We talked dinner dates and the importance of an egalitarian relationship, where the woman feels respected and not just seen as the person who does all the housework, cooking and cleaning. It was magic. And did they all seem to take on your advice? Nicole kept the conversation going, liking the way it was headed. I would say 50% of them seemed to have a light bulb moment. It was like, oh, so if I cook and clean after myself, my relationship might be a bit easier. They were genuinely surprised. And the other 50%? Either they already knew and were set, or, oh, they didn't care and had no intention of changing. Nicole felt a wave of relief. This was pretty good content. This was something women of all ages could relate to. She could count on Audrey to keep their head above water. They were sinking, and she didn't know how to save them. Things ticked over, but the reality was, these days, things needed to explode if they were going to succeed. Something like a podcast with Audrey Westwood should have been a total hit. Graham had said he was behind her, but she knew that he too saw her as a failure. Perhaps that was why he had suddenly become very distant, more so than he had been for the last few years. They'd had their problems. He wanted children, and she didn't like to think about it. But these last few months, she had felt him slipping away. And that, I'm afraid, is all we have time for this week on Laying It Bare. Please do join us again next time when we will be speaking to a sleep expert. So, anyone with any insomnia issues, do get in touch via email at the usual address or through any of our social channels with your questions. And remember that rating the podcast is the best way to help us get heard by more listeners. Thanks again. Audrey wrapped up as she always did. Nicole was fine with that. Let Audrey have her moment. Audrey slipped off her headphones, pushed her chair back and crossed her legs, long limbs that were the very essence of who she was. Nicole clocked a white Gucci suitcase against the wall and then looked at Audrey. The size of it, she said. Audrey shrugged. Well, I thought to myself, if I must. Audrey rolled her eyes dramatically as she made what must have been the 50th joke about not coming on the last-minute working holiday that Nicole had organised. Nicole had only known Audrey for just under a year, and this was to be their first holiday away together. Albeit the trip was primarily to brainstorm ideas, what better way to get to know someone than on holiday? Then a tingle crept up her back and her neck, making her shudder as she thought about the reality of being there with her colleagues and the significance of the date that was fast approaching. It was going to be okay, she assured herself, but she had barely slept that night. She was feeling fragile, as though she needed an extra layer on. Bit chilly, isn't it, with that aircon? Audrey, who must have seen Nicole's involuntary shiver, picked up the white remote control and pointed it at the slim machine on the ceiling. The temperature of the room immediately rose. Nicole smiled at Audrey for her perceptiveness. Another great show, you two. Matt walked across the room from the mixing desk in the corner. Audrey smiled excessively. Always eager to please, she said with a wink and a shimmy of her shoulders. Audrey could flirt for England, men and women alike. They all just seemed to melt at her words, the way Matt did every time. His face flushed slightly, but his eyes twinkled. It amazed Nicole how one woman could elicit different kinds of uncontrollable behaviours in people. She didn't class it as a skill as such. It was just something innate that people like Audrey were born with. She was a people magnet. Nicole had witnessed it hundreds of times in the last year or so since she had known Audrey. The handful of times she had seen Graham change his entire persona when Audrey graced him with some of her finest lines had unsettled her. But she had smiled through it, an inane grin that told Audrey and everyone else in the vicinity that she was secure in her relationship, that she found Audrey's comments cute but entirely unthreatening. "I'm all set for the girls' weekend," Audrey said to Matt, gesturing to the suitcase again. Matt followed her gaze and raised his eyebrows comically. "Got a body in there," he said. "Only everything I need for this one." Audrey ran her hands over the top half of her curves, and Matt shook his head, his face flushing beetroot. Nicole felt herself deflate. Audrey always looked on the bright side, always ready to turn any situation into fun. Nicole had made it clear to Audrey that things were teetering, that she needed to get back in control. She had made it clear there was a real purpose to this trip, and so she had made a last-minute decision for them to all retreat to her family holiday home in Dorset, the beach house. She didn't want to shell out on accommodation for them all. The accounts wouldn't stretch to a Holiday Inn down the road in their current state. Yet she needed them all in the same place for several days to make any dent in the problem. She would have been there anyway this weekend, more so than any weekend, and so here she was, killing two birds with one stone. The beach house had always had a hold on Nicole. It had been the holiday home that she had spent so many days, months, and years of her life in, and despite the memories that crippled her daily, like an abused child who always returned to their primary caregiver, Nicole would always go back there to seek sanctuary, for solace. She would find it, but she had to take the other emotions that came with it, and in the next few hours, she would be home again. She only hoped this time the old place would be kind to her, because she had a job to do, and that wasn't just trying to save the studio. Nicole looked over at Audrey again as she continued to embarrass Matt without a care. Her visit home wasn't just business, it was also personal. Chapter 2. Margo. Margo hated packing to go away. She laid her clothes on the bed and shook her head in dismay at the dismal ensembles. She wasn't a shopper. Not like Nicole or Paisley, and certainly not like Audrey. Oh, Lord, Audrey. How was Margo going to survive 3 days and nights under the same roof as a supermodel? Margo scoped Audrey's social media accounts regularly. The woman was a goddess. There were no two ways about it. Every piece of clothing she wore looked brand new and immaculate, and everything always fitted her curves perfectly. Margo had thought about a little shopping spree prior to the trip, but had run out of time. Her work always came before any other normal activity that other people enjoyed. Margo worked hard, but she also loved working. It was, you could say, her life, which was why this trip away that Nicole had organized hadn't brought her out in hives. Normally, the very thought of socializing made Margo jittery, but she knew it was time to brainstorm ideas for the podcast and the business, as Margo was also fully aware of how much trouble the studio was in. And if the studio wasn't there, then Margo was out of a job. And if she was out of a job, then what else did she really have? Working at the studio suited her entire personality. Jobs were like romantic partners. You only ever got a couple of chances at finding the one. And her position at the studio was her true love. She would do everything she could to keep it afloat. She wasn't thrilled about the weekend away because it was still out of her comfort zone, and there would be times when she would have to stop talking about work and look as though she were relaxing and enjoying a glass of wine. But stranger things had happened, Margot thought to herself as she piled her conservative wardrobe into a suitcase that hadn't seen daylight for over 6 years. That was the last time she had been on holiday, and she hadn't even left the country. Things had got worse with her dad. He needed her now all the time. Work was the one thing she had that not only kept her sane, but helped pay for the carers. She hadn't meant to let home life and work consume her, and it wasn't that Nicole was high maintenance, but she had said on more than one occasion that she simply couldn't live without her. And so when the texts came through late at night, asking her to engage with something on social media, of course, Margot would answer them. She had been Nicole's personal assistant for a year, but she still hadn't worked out why Nicole was so averse to being on Instagram and why she only hung around behind the brand of the studio. Margot peered out of the window to assess the weather. Should she pack another jumper? Should she put on a thicker cardigan for the journey? Her attention was drawn to a parked car a little way along the street, and she thought she noticed a sudden movement from the person sitting in the driver's seat. They had pulled the visor down, though, so she couldn't see their face. Margot felt her gut tighten. She knew what date had been and gone, and her eyes had been on the road outside her house for the last few days. It was just typical that Nicole needed her at a time when she really needed to be here, keeping an eye on the house and making sure it and her father were safe. She had been expecting a knock on the door any day now. Suddenly, a shout and a loud smash sent Margot running for the door and hurtling down the stairs. "What happened?" she cried, her voice high and stretched. "What the hell, Dad?" She stood at the entrance to the kitchen and looked at her 83-year-old father standing amongst the debris of a smashed cup and saucer. He eyed her for a second, then bent to pick it up. Margot leapt forwards. "No!" she screamed, and her father almost fell back against the work surface. "Shit!" Margot yelped, and lifted her foot up and saw she had stepped in a piece of china. A thin sliver had wedged itself in her foot. She pulled it out and winced at the pain. She should really wash and dress that, but she would be late. At least it was her left foot, which wouldn't be doing any work in her automatic car. "Honestly, Dad, Siobhan will be here soon. Can you please not touch anything until then?" Margot's dad looked on with bewilderment. "Eric!" Margot tried again, loud enough that it brought her dad back into the room from wherever he had just been in his mind. "I need you to sit down and wait until Siobhan gets here. Then she will look after you. Do you think you can do that?" Margot took her dad's arm and escorted him around the broken crockery and into the dining room. "Here, sit down. I'll make you a cup of tea." Margot felt the familiar swell of guilt rising through her body whenever she got cross with her father. It was, of course, the onset of dementia. But she had yet to fully address it. She just didn't have the time. She brought in help occasionally and made sure he was comfortable, but leaving him alone in the day was getting more and more dangerous. She needed to employ someone full-time, but the cost of that was just too much for her to take on right now. And with the studio in financial jeopardy, she couldn't just ask Nicole for a pay rise, even though she had been there for a year now, and she was overdue her promised 12-month pay rise. She began preparing a pot of tea for her dad, and whilst the kettle boiled, she swept up the debris from the kitchen floor, making sure she got in all the corners in case her dad walked in with bare feet. She carried the tea with a milk jug and a bowl of sugar to the dining room, where her father was still sitting, tapping his right fingers on the table and staring out of the window. Margot always left the curtains open here, as it looked out onto the main street, meaning Eric could have a view out onto the world from his seat here, as well as from his spot in the living room, which looked out over the small, unkempt garden, even though he rarely looked out of the window in there because he was usually glued to the TV. Margot went to the window and strained to look up and down the road. She couldn't see Siobhan's car anywhere. It was almost 2, and Siobhan was usually early by at least 5 minutes. Margot needed to leave as soon as she arrived. It was almost a 3-hour drive to Nicole's beach house, and she had wanted to give herself plenty of time to arrive. Dinner was at 7, and Margot liked to have time to acclimatize when she arrived somewhere new. Her armpits began to prickle with sweat. Was Siobhan going to turn up? Had she been delayed, or couldn't make it anymore, meaning Margot would have to stay behind? A part of her wondered if she would be thankful not to have to go this weekend, if the absence of a carer for her father was all she needed to get out of having to be sociable with the likes of Audrey. If she could just stay here where it was safe, where she could keep a personal eye on her dad and not leave him vulnerable. Margot's stomach dropped again at the thought of leaving her father. But she needed to think about finishing packing if she was going to make it at all today. She cursed herself for not investing in some outfits and for not making the time to shop properly. She raced back upstairs, finishing throwing a few last essentials in, and then dragged her suitcase downstairs. She glanced a look at herself in the mirror. Jeans, a nice top, and boots. The go-to standard outfit she had been rocking for almost 20 years. She thought about the look she used to wear. It wasn't such a long time ago, was it? She used to take so many more risks with what she wore. Now it was all about feeling comfortable, safe. It was all about just blending in to bring some confidence and to not attract too much attention. But despite the clothes she wore to give her that feeling, she felt anything but confident. Putting her trust in Siobhan had taken a lot. Finally, the doorbell rang and Margot breathed a little easier. She swung the door open. But there, in the place where she had expected to see Siobhan, was someone else. A tall woman who looked Spanish or Italian, her hair scraped back in what was seemingly the signature carer low bun, and wearing a uniform from the caring agency that she had hired Siobhan from several weeks ago.
Hello, I'm Clarissa.
She smiled and flashed brilliant white teeth. There was a hint of a European accent there, one that had been lost over time.
You're not Siobhan,
Margot said flatly, her stomach churning as she mulled over all the issues this woman's presence now raised. She would have to go through her father's routine and show her where everything was in the house. Should she even choose to let her in? She hadn't been given any notice from the agency. She had a good mind to call them. But she was running late.
I'm sorry about that.
Clarissa looked a little perturbed by Margot's directness, and the smile was almost lost for a second, before she brought it back.
Siobhan is ill, and so I was asked to step in. I am very familiar with last-minute jobs, so I am sure.
But you don't know my father, Margot interrupted. And just now, he had an accident with the tea, and I'm due to leave any minute. I don't have time to show you everything. Margot heard the strain in her voice. She took a deep breath.
This is bad management. I will speak with your agency.
Clarissa stood even taller than she had been, as though she had just taken in a huge breath.
I can assure you this is normal practice for our agency. If your usual carer is unavailable, we always send someone else to replace them. We pride ourselves on this.
Clarissa looked happy with herself as she said this, and because Margot was unfamiliar with caring agencies, she had only been using the service for a month, and not because she had wanted to, she felt she had no choice. Her father couldn't be left alone. She couldn't be here every day and night to watch over him, and if she didn't go soon, she was going to be late. If she didn't show up to this meeting, retreat, whatever this was supposed to be, she could be fired. Nicole might let her go because she could barely afford to keep the business afloat as it was. She stood back so that Clarissa could come into the house.
Dad's through there,
Margot said, gesturing to the dining room before peering out along the street. The car was still parked on the curb with someone inside. Did people have nothing better to do than sit in their cars, making others feel unsettled? She closed the door and followed behind Clarissa and watched as the woman fell into her role immediately, asking if Eric needed more hot water for his pot and trying to engage him in conversation about his day so far. It all seemed perfectly fine, but Margot couldn't shake the annoyance. It wasn't convenient to just send someone else. It was a deviation she didn't need right now. But she also needed to be on the work trip. She just needed to get on the road now and hope that she would start to mellow out in the right frame of mind for the weekend away. Margot took a second to assess her emotions, where they were stemming from, why there was a muddle in her mind. She always conjured up her mother's words when she felt this way.
untangle that knot of nerves. She glanced out of the window again, and then back at Clarissa through her doorway of the dining room. She was a professional. She was going to look after her dad in the same way that Siobhan did. But that was not what was bothering her. She looked at the car again, at the figure in the driver's seat, slightly visible but not enough to decipher their features. She felt her gut swirl. Were her instincts right? Should she just go on outside and approach the car? She felt her gut wrench at what might happen whilst she was away. Margot broke her gaze away from the window. Her mind was made up. She had to take the chance. She had to go to work. Margot went into the dining room, gave her father an awkward hug, which was not reciprocated, and then smiled uneasily at Clarissa. Margot scribbled her number down on a post-it note, along with the address of the beach house, and stuck it on the bureau in the corner of the dining room, next to the window. Then she backed out of the door, carrying her suitcase and placing it in the boot of her car. She sat in the driver's seat and looked back at the house. She could see Clarissa moving about through the dining room window. Margot took a deep breath and tried to think like someone who could drive away and forget about things, out of sight, out of mind. But that was never going to be Margot. There was too much at stake here. What was she thinking, going away on such a whim? She hadn't been able to say no to Nicole. She tried to look back along the street to see if the person was still in the car, but her view was restricted. Margot swiped at the sat-nav to tap in the postcode for the beach house. 3 hours and 15 minutes from Putney. She hoped she wouldn't catch the school run or workers leaving early. As she pulled away, thoughts of her father and the potential danger she was leaving him in were replaced by a memory from a few weeks ago at the studio's first birthday party. What she had seen haunted her dreams as much as the worries about her father. Margot worked pretty closely with Nicole most days, but this long weekend was going to be something else. She was going to be with Nicole 24/7 for 3 nights, and that made the thing she had witnessed even harder to bear. How could she look Nicole in the eye, knowing what she knew? And for the next 3 hours, that was all that would be playing over and over in her mind. Chapter 3. Paisley. The app was open on Paisley's phone. She had closed the map once she had arrived at the beach house, and there it was, open on her screen. The damn app, always there, taunting her, reminding her of her failings. Oh, well, she thought, she may as well use it one last time before she stepped over the threshold. For once she was there inside the beach house, things were going to change. She would never need to use gambling apps again. She'd run out of options. All but one remained. Even though Paisley knew what the word addict meant, she would never still attribute it to herself, God no. She knew she was in trouble. She knew she needed to stop, but she wasn't an addict. Addicts were those people who showed up to groups in cold, stark village halls on a Tuesday night, drank insipid tea and took turns to monologue about their sad little journeys. No. Paisley had thought a lot about this, and she had decided that was not her. She was just a young woman who opened an app on her phone and spent some money from time to time. Well, that time to time had been every day. And now she'd maxed out. She didn't have bailiffs banging down her door, but soon the loans would need to be paid off. She pressed the button for one more spin. She held her breath and closed her eyes. This would be the one. This would be the spin that would bring her the win that she needed to get herself sorted. She was somewhere new. She was by the sea. Her luck would surely change this time. She had been on a losing streak for far too long. This was how it was supposed to be, in her car, in a beautiful part of the country, a positive future ahead of her.
She would open her eyes, see the stunning surroundings again, and then look down at her win. It was meant to be this way. She opened her eyes, and instead of looking at the surroundings first, her eyes fell straight to her smartphone, to the app, and to the news that made her want to rip herself out of her skin. She let out a guttural primal scream. No tears came, just a slow release of rage. She stayed still for a little while. The tears didn't come, they never did. So she had to wait for the echo of the scream to subside in her head. Then she could take a deep breath and move on. Several minutes later, Paisley was still sitting in her car. To a passerby, the scene would look perfectly innocent, as though nothing had happened to her. Paisley was adept at hiding her emotions. The lack of tears helped. Teaching yourself not to cry from a very young age was a skill not many could perfect. But that first humiliating sports day as a 5-year-old girl had brought a tsunami of tears that made it seem as though the entire school were laughing at her. In hindsight, she knew it was just the bullies, but it was enough to make her wipe away those tears and learn how to stop them coming any time she felt frustrated, humiliated, or just plain old desperate. The sting in her eyes would be fierce, but she would manage to stop the flow. She stared at the beach house, a white building with a grey slated roof and a long, steep driveway, surrounded by a clear aura of cloudless blue. Paisley couldn't work out where the sky ended and where the sea began. How did someone get so lucky to have a house like this in their family? How did Nicole get so lucky? Nicole had told them all about how the house had been bought by her parents in the 80s. She'd holidayed here as a child, and over the years her parents had done it up until they split. Nicole, her mother, and her stepfather came here for occasional weekends and Christmases, and now Nicole used it for her own leisure. When she organised the working weekend, it was obvious this was where it would take place. Paisley supposed it suited Nicole perfectly because everything did. That was exactly what Nicole was about. Paisley felt that familiar surge of rage. Nicole, at the age of 33, had managed to cement such an ideal life. Her own business, a nice pad in London with her boyfriend Graham, and now Paisley was finally seeing the beach house with her own eyes, the place she had heard mentioned occasionally when Nicole was on a call, presumably to her mum or Graham. It had always seemed like an enigma. The beach house. Words that she'd heard in whispered phone calls and hushed conversations. Apart from Nicole, Paisley didn't know anyone rich enough to own a house this size and not live in it permanently. Paisley swallowed down the anger and left it alone, where it would fester in the pit of her stomach with all the other discarded emotions. 3 nights did feel like a rather long time to be shacked up in a house on the edge of nowhere with 3 other women she didn't know particularly well. Well, she did know them, but only in the professional sense, based on the odd after-work drink. And then, of course, there had been the party 6 weeks ago. Paisley could never forget that. She had seen a side of some of her colleagues that she'd never seen before. That night changed everything. But still, a holiday away was how you really got to know someone, wasn't it? Paisley guessed this was the reason for the get-together in the first place. Aside from the fact that they did have an inordinate amount of work-related issues to bash out, there was never enough time at the studio to truly socialise because people kept coming and going, and there was always so much happening with recordings. Plus, Paisley spent a lot of time talking very quietly so as not to disturb anyone. Paisley stepped out of the car. The sea breeze swept across her cheeks, and she felt a sudden rush of dizziness and her stomach churned. She took 3 long, deep breaths and stood up straight, looking up at the building in front of her. There were no other cars there, so she was the first to arrive. But that was how she wanted it. It was important for her to get her bearings. Paisley always liked to be the first to arrive for anything. But to be here first at Nicole's felt even more important on this occasion. She felt as though she needed to familiarize herself, set her roots down before anyone else arrived. The beach house sat upon a hill. A path ran past it and continued along the cliff face before disappearing from Paisley's view from the bottom of the driveway. She glanced to the left, where a cluster of trees ran parallel to the house. From where Paisley stood, the sun caught her eye through a gap in the foliage, and for a second, she was sure she saw someone, a woman. She blinked firmly a few times and lifted her hand to block the sun, but there was no one there. Paisley watched the space for a minute, enjoying the smattering of heat. She saw that the garden was raised above the house at the back, and a bench was situated just to the side. The perfect little sun trap. Paisley thought she would get herself settled and sit out with one of the herbal teas that she had brought with her, and, despite the coastal breeze, make the most of the afternoon sun. She had brought quite a few extra food items with her, even though she had heard Nicole had hired in a chef for the weekend. She liked to be prepared. And despite feeling a little out of sorts, Paisley was prepared for everything that this weekend was about to bring. Nicole had told everyone the code for the lockbox so that whoever arrived first could let themselves in. Paisley felt a swell of empowerment as she found the lockbox on the side of the house by the bins and typed in the code. The box flipped open and she took out the key and felt the warmth of the metal against the flat of her palm. She looked around again at how secluded she was here. There was a glimpse of another house to the right, but that was it. A flutter of panic and joy muddled together in the pit of her stomach. Anything could happen here, and no one would know. She looked down to the right, where she could see a glimpse of the beach, and spotted a lone walker. She looked up at the path that ran along the cliff, and then down to her right, where a rustic, steep path led down to the sand, and Paisley wondered if she would venture down there at all. Paisley watched the walker on the beach. She looked for longer, as she realized she was waiting to see a dog run up alongside them, but none appeared. The walker was alone. She pushed the key into the door and stepped inside. The scent of fresh wood and newness was all around her, as though the place had been painted recently. She dropped her bag in the hallway and bathed in the expanse of light. Just off the hallway was an open-plan communal area with a gleaming white kitchen complete with a large island. A swell of excitement and desire swelled in her body. She began the exploration. Nicole had mentioned that she occupied the room on the second floor with a sea view, and Paisley wanted to see which one it was before everyone else arrived. She walked through into the kitchen diner first, which boasted large modern grey sofas and a coffee table next to floor-to-ceiling windows with a magnificent sea view. As well as the large island in the middle of the kitchen area, there was also a long wooden dining table that would easily seat 12. It was the perfect family entertaining space. Paisley thought about Nicole, who didn't have her own family. It was something she didn't really speak about. The huge beach house all to herself, yet no little ones to fill all the little nooks and crannies. Paisley wondered how much Nicole thought about the lack of tiny bare feet slapping against the cold hard tiles of this room. How was it possible to own such a huge house, to have it handed down to you, and only live in it occasionally? Paisley knew that whilst there was still time for Nicole to become a mother, it was not really on her agenda. It would never be on Nicole's agenda. Paisley closed her eyes, and for a second, she could almost hear the sound of children's laughter echoing around the vast, sparse room. She smiled softly to herself and opened her eyes. She listened to the screech of a seagull that had landed in the garden on a hexagon-shaped summer house, and she suddenly felt very at home. Downstairs and off the hallway to her left was a utility room, a further study and a small bedroom. Paisley took herself upstairs with her bag and looked into each of the other four bedrooms, all lightly decorated, each with their own individual style. She stood in one with its king-sized bed, made up with crisp white sheets and plump pillows that stood upright against the headboard, like something straight out of a boutique hotel. A light sandy-coloured throw was spread neatly across the end of the bed for those chilly evenings. Paisley imagined herself sat in the chair by the window, drinking a warm beverage and watching the sunrise. This would do nicely, she thought to herself. She found Nicole's room next door. It was decorated the same, but two floral cushions were on the bed. The bedside table was adorned with scented candles, a new-looking hardback notepad, and a pot of hair ties, arranged neatly by the housekeeping staff, no doubt. Paisley walked over to the wardrobe, clicked it open, and drank in the expensive fabrics that hung in front of her. Something for every season and weather. Nicole was tall and slim, and nothing in that wardrobe would have fit Paisley, who was only 5'5½". The half was very important. There was also a dressing table that caught Paisley's eye. Pots of creams and ornate bottles of perfumes that Paisley knew cost a small fortune were all lined up in neat rows, and a small vase of pink and purple flowers sat on the corner of the table. Paisley bent down and pulled open the top drawer. Inside were more toiletries and makeup products all arranged neatly in small acrylic lidless receptacles. Paisley perused the colours and brands for a moment before finally plunging her hand in and picking out a small black tube. She popped the lid off, sniffed the lipstick, and applied a little. It smelt expensive and felt like...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.